Hello, and welcome to another episode of Dechert's Global Broadcast Series, our short update on items we think matter most to PE professionals in the COVID-19 era. Today, we're going to discuss a wave of disputes arising from deals signed before the current crisis that have not yet closed, focusing on what we think is driving these disputes and what are some key takeaways for PE dealmaking going forward. My name is Melanie MacKay, and I'm an associate in our Trial Investigations and Securities Group based in the Chicago office.
Hi, I'm Mark Thierfelder. I chair the Corporate and Securities Practice, and I'm based in our New York office.
And I'm Neil Steiner, a partner in our Trial Investigations and Securities Group, also based in New York.
Neil, Mark, thanks for joining me. Let's get right to it. Mark, there are a number of complaints already filed in the Delaware Chancery Court, plus other disputes in other jurisdictions, and that's on top of disputes that have yet to enter the litigation phase. The last time we saw a wave of disputes like this was during the Great Financial Crisis. Back then, the issue that drove a lot of the litigation was whether the target business had suffered a material adverse effect, or MAE. We explored the MAE issue in our very first podcast of this series on March 20th. As we discussed then, the courts have consistently ruled that there is a very high bar to proving an MAE. Since buyers now know how hard it is to win an MAE claim, what do you think will be the hotly disputed issue this time around?
Melanie, I agree that standalone MAE litigation, at least at this phase of the pandemic crisis, is less likely this time around. And while buyers may not abandon MAE arguments altogether, the COVID-era disputes seem to be centered around other issues, and in particular around the seller's interim operating covenant.
I've seen that. In what way?
Well, to take a step back, an interim operating covenant essentially requires the seller to continue to operate the business that is as it has historically done. These covenants are designed to preserve the value of the target business after the deal is signed. Right now, as everyone knows, due to various government orders and other responses to the pandemic, we're seeing a lot of businesses close operations, furlough employees, fail to pay rent, and similar items. Those decisions can have a very negative impact on the target business. So a buyer might argue that a company taking those drastic measures is not operating consistently with how it has operated historically, and thus is not complying with its interim operating covenants. The irony here is that while sellers in the past have often pushed to include the phrase consistent with past practice as a qualifier to the ordinary course covenant as a way to give themselves flexibility to operate the business as they have traditionally done so, right now, as sellers are forced to take highly unusual steps, it's an open question as to how sellers feel about having that phrase included in the contract.
Got it. Neil, if this is the buyer's argument, what are their chances of success as compared to winning on an MAE claim?
It's a great question, Melanie, since as our listeners likely know, the MAE standard is an incredibly high one. In fact, only one Delaware court has ever found an MAE to have occurred, and the facts and circumstances supporting that ruling were quite extreme, which illustrates just how difficult it can be to prove an MAE. So I agree with Mark that we may see more buyers arguing today that sellers failed to adhere to their interim operating covenants. The merits of this argument are going to depend on the specific terms of the contract, but the advantage for the buyer is that, for purposes of an agreement's closing conditions, most deals require sellers to comply with their covenants in all material respects. So instead of a buyer having to prove the vaunted MAE standard, the buyer in this type of dispute need only prove that the seller fell short of operating the business in the ordinary course in all material respects. And that, I think, is a much easier standard for the buyer to prove, at least in theory.
Makes sense, Neil. So at first blush, it seems like a seller's decision to close stores or take other drastic measures is an obvious failure to operate in the ordinary course. But I have a suspicion you're going to tell me that perhaps the issue is more nuanced.
Exactly. I am going to tell you that. The buyer will argue that these pandemic responses are decidedly not operating in the ordinary course. But on the flip side, sellers will argue that the actions they took are in fact ordinary course. It's ordinary for how a seller would navigate through a crisis. When it comes to closing stores in compliance with government orders, for example, a seller may say that compliance with government orders is and always has been its practice. Sellers may also compare the measures they are taking today to the types of measures that they or other companies took during the financial crisis or in the aftermath of 9/11, or even as compared to the actions that their competitors are taking now. Another thing to keep in mind is that most operating covenants allow the seller to engage in activity outside the ordinary course as long as it gains the buyer's consent, which the buyer cannot unreasonably withhold. And finally, some judges might be receptive to an argument that if the contract carves out COVID-related events from the definition of an MAE, that shows the party's agreement on how to allocate COVID-related risks as well, such that the buyer should not be able to read in a backdoor COVID closing condition through the ordinary course standard. So it'll certainly be an interesting dispute, and if it plays out in the courts, we could end up with some very useful judicial guidance on just what the phrase ordinary course of business consistent with past practice means in a situation like this.
Okay. Well, clearly none of us have a crystal ball, so it's impossible to know how courts will enforce interim operating covenants amidst the pandemic. And sometimes the uncertainty of the outcome combined with the cost of litigation is reason enough to avoid the dispute. Mark, do you see other benefits on the part of buyers in raising these disputes anyway, whether in or out of court?
Well, there certainly could be, Melanie, but it largely depends on what the buyer is trying to achieve and on how much leverage the buyer has, which in turn will depend on the type of damages the buyer might face and how much the buyer has to lose as a consequence. In other words, what sort of remedies can the seller demand? Specific performance before termination? Or if the agreement is terminated, can the seller get damages? And if they can get damages, are they capped or unlimited? These are factors any buyer will need to consider before raising disputes, attempting to renegotiate the deal, or attempting to back out of the deal altogether.
Do you think we will see more buyers trying to renegotiate signed deals or actually backing out altogether?
Look, I'd observe that historically, buyers did not typically raise these disputes in order to go all the way to trial or to get out of the deal altogether, but instead as a way to bring the seller back to the negotiating table to discuss a price cut. One question is whether, in the current environment, does that remain true? Due to the uncertainty of the length and severity of the coronavirus impact on the economy and on the target business specifically, perhaps buyers are more interested in actually backing out of the deal entirely. Even if not, just delaying the closing and raising the specter of significant legal fees may apply enough pressure to bring about the buyer's desired result. Of course, buyers may not even know what they want right now, so they may raise disputes just to buy time and see how events play out with respect to the target.
And another thing to keep in mind is where the dispute might get litigated. New York courts are generally reluctant to grant specific performance, but if you're in an equitable court like the Delaware Chancery Court, the seller may have a better chance at securing specific performance. So as Mark already stressed, it's important for a buyer to keep in mind the types of remedies a seller might have, as well as the time to get there.
As you watch these disputes play out, what are the key takeaways for companies who have already penned their deals or are in the process of negotiating them?
Well, I think focusing on the pressure points is key. A lawsuit may not go to trial, but the longer it drags on, the heavier the pressure to renegotiate becomes. Not to mention that 6 months or a year from now, the effects on the target business with hindsight may start to look more durationally significant and more plausibly like an MAE. So the question isn't just did the seller breach its interim operating covenant, but also what are the facts, what result are you trying to achieve, and what exposure do you have? And that's the case whether you're the buyer or the seller in this situation.
I absolutely agree, Neil, Melanie. I think the best thing parties currently negotiating a deal can do is clarify in their agreement, including the operating covenant, just what the seller can and cannot do in response to COVID-19. Obviously, the MAE definition should also be clear about whether or not COVID-related effects are or are not carved out. Just as any negotiation, it's all a question of how the parties want to allocate risk, and the parties should be very clear about which party is shouldering COVID-related risks. There are also, of course, ways to structure deals so that one party doesn't bear the entire COVID-related risk, as we've discussed during our episode on strategies for bridging valuation gaps. For example, parties might use earnout mechanisms or toll holds and other minority investments to share risk. Another interesting thing to consider, particularly as debt financing might be drying up, is whether we will start to see deals that are fully equity backstopped, and somewhat relatedly, whether we will see the dollar value of reverse termination fees begin to creep upward, which would be a reversal of the trend that we have been recently seeing.
Mark and Neil, thank you both. This was great. Everyone out there, thank you for listening. We hope to cover many more of your questions over the coming weeks, so if you have thoughts or topics you'd like to see covered, please reach out to any of your Dechert relationships to share them. You can find all of our coronavirus resources at www.dechert.com, including other PE Global broadcasts as they become available. Stay safe and healthy, everyone.